A very good morning. Today we are going to discuss about subdivision mesenchymicodina, which are commonly called as club fungi. Now, regarding the salient features of this group, the mycelium is septate and multicellular, and there is a special kind of septum that is seen in this group, which is called as dolichoseptum, which is unlike the simple septum that is found in other groups. And the presence of clams also signify this group. The fruiting bodies are called as basidiocarps. The reproductive structures are basidia, which bear four haploid basidiospores. And these basidiospores, they are born at the tips of minute stalks called as pterygnata. Asexual reproduction can take place by means of conidia, oidia, chlamydospores. And sexuality, it is not conspicuous in this group. Distinct male and female sex organs are absent. The dikaryotization of the hyphae, it occurs following the plasmogamy. The motile phase, it is absent altogether in the life cycle of Basidium mycetes. And it is like the one that we have already seen in the case of Ascomycetes. Now, regarding the vegetative structure, well-developed filamentar mycelium, which may be white, bright yellow or orange colored, can be seen in this group. In some genera, like Armillaria, the mycelial hyphae run parallel to each other and form thick cords or strands called as rhizomorphs. Now, the cell wall, it is made up of chitin. Adjacent cells are separated from each other by means of a special kind of septa called as dolichore septa. Now, it is special because it is surrounded by a thick rim and protected by a cap on either sides called as paranthosome. The mycelium of Basidium mycotina passes through three successive stages of development, namely primary mycelium, secondary mycelium and tertiary mycelium. Now, this is the figure showing the dolichoseptum. You can see that these are the bracket-shaped structures called as paranthosomes. Now, this is again a comparison between the simple septum that is found in the Ascomycetes and the complex septum that is found in the Basidium mycetes. This is the dolichoseptum that is seen in Basidium mycetes. Now, the primary mycelium, it is monokaryotic and it is formed by the germination of basidiospore. It represents the haplophase of the life cycle, that means the haploid phase of the life cycle. The primary mycelium at maturity is septate with single nuclei in each cell. Now, the primary mycelium is of very short existence, and during this period, it can multiply asexually by means of conidia or oidia and does not form the basidiospores. The secondary mycelium, it consists of hyphae with binucleate cells. It represents the dikaryophase of the life cycle, that means the dikaryotic phase. Now, Basidium mycotina has prolonged dikaryotic phase as compared to the Ascomycotina. Secondary mycelium, it develops from primary mycelium by a process called as dikaryotization or diploidization. Secondary mycelium may produce dikaryotic oidia, uridospores, teleospores, basidia, and basidiospores. That means it is capable of producing several types of spores. Depends upon the genus. The methods of dikaryotization. How does the hypha get dikaryotized? By the union of two primary hyphae of opposite strains, or by the somatogamy between two uninucleate cells of primary hyphae of opposite strains, or by the fusion between two germ tubes of two basidiospores of opposite strains, or by the fusion of two basidiospores. So, by these methods, dikaryotization can occur in Basidium mycetes. Now, regarding the tertiary mycelium, it is a complex tissue formed by the organized arrangement of secondary mycelium. Cells are dikaryotic, and the tertiary mycelium is common in the fruiting bodies, that is the basidiocarps. So, these are the clam connections that I was talking about, that it is characteristic of Basidium mycetes. It has a characteristic bridge-like backward outgrowth from the dividing dikaryotic cell, characteristic of Basidium mycotina. except in the case of rust. You don't find clam connections in rust fungi. So again, a photograph showing the clams seen under the microscope. Now, the reproduction in this group can occur either by vegetative, asexual, or sexual means. The vegetative reproduction can take place by means of fragmentation and budding. Asexual reproduction, as I told you, can take place by different types of spores like conidia, that is in the case of rusts, muds, etc., or by means of oidia, or by means of chlamydospores. Now, the sexual reproduction, it is very complicated and it involves plasmogamy, karyogamy, and meiosis. Plasmogamy, it leads to the formation of a dikaryotic mycelium. Plasmogamy takes place by somatogamy or by means of spermatization. In spermatization, fusion occurs between the spermatium of one strain and the receptive hyphae of the opposite strain. Now, the dikaryon, it grows by cell division and clam connections. The cilia are formed from the dikaryotic. Karyogamy and meiosis, it results in the formation of basidiospores. Now, these basidiospores, they are different from ascospores and ascomycetes in the fact that basidiospores are produced exogenously on the basidium, whereas the ascospores, they were produced inside, so they were produced endogenously in the ascospores. So, this is one of the major differences between ascomycetes and basidiomycetes. In basidiomycetes, the basidiospores are produced exogenously on the basidium, and the basidiospores during the formation of basidiospores, small outgrowths with swollen tips are given out from the basidium, and these are called as steragmata. Into each of these steragmata, the haploid nucleus that was formed by meiosis migrates, and eventually the steragmatal swellings develop to basidiospores. Thus, basidiospores are small, thin-walled, haploid, and uninucleate cells which are produced exogenously on the basidium. Now, usually, a basidium bears 4 basidiospores. This is again in contrast with the ascomycetes group, where usually 8 ascospores are produced inside a single ascus. Here in basidiomycetes, there are 4 basidiospores which are produced exogenously on a basidium. Each basidiospore has a lateral outgrowth at its junction with the stigma called as hilum. At maturity, the basidiospores are explosively ejected from the stigma. And these basidiospores now germinate to form the primary mycelium. Basidia are reproductive structures which bear basidiospores and correspond to the ascus of ascomycota that I have already mentioned. Now, there are two major types of basidia, namely holobasidia and phragmobasidia. Now, holobasidia, they are also called as haplobasidia. Now, they are cylindrical, non-septate, and apically rounded basidia. That means they are club-shaped. The holobasidium, it develops from the terminal cell of the dikaryotic type. Now, the nucleus in this cell, it fuses to form a diploid nucleus and then undergoes meiosis. 4 steragmata, they are produced exogenously on this basidia. Now, nuclei migrate into it and the stigma becomes the basidiospores. That means each basidia now carries 4 basidiospores. So, this is the case regarding holobasidia. Holo means entire. That means the entire cell there, the tip of that dikaryotic hypha, that cell, it becomes the complete basidia, that is holobasidia. So, this is the picture showing the structure of a holobasidium. You can see that this is the terminal cell of the dikaryotic hypha, inside which the 2 nuclei had fused and they underwent meiosis, and then the 4 projections were formed. These are called as steragmata. Now, the tip of these steragmata cell, into which the each of the 4 haploid nuclei migrate, and later this transforms into a basidiospore. Phragmobasidia, these are elongated cylindrical septate and apically rounded basidia, characteristic of rusts and smuts. Now they develop from special binucleate spores called as teleutospores or teleospores that we have already seen while learning practicals in the case of Puccinia. Now the two nuclei of the spores, they fuse to form a diploid nucleus. Now the spore undergoes germination and forms a tubular and non-septate germ tube called as probasidium. The diploid nucleus migrates into it and divides meiotically, producing four haploid nuclei. Now the probasidium undergoes septation and becomes four-celled. A stigma develops on each side of the cell. A nucleus migrates into it and forms a basidiospore. On attaining maturity, the spores get ejected from the stigmata and germinate to new mycelium. So this is called as phragmobasidia. That means the basidium is fragmented. So this is how it takes place. See, this is the teleutospore. You can see the germ tube coming out of the cell of the teleutospore, and the promycelium, it is now septate, and the nucleus that had gone there, it underwent meiosis, producing four haploid nuclei. And after the production of four haploid nuclei, the septation has taken place, and then each of the cell has produced a basidiospore. Now, regarding the economic importance of Basidiomycota, several mushrooms and puffballs are edible. Now, Clavatia, it is believed to contain certain anti-cancer substances like clavicin. Now, many club fungi, they cause serious diseases to crop plants like rusts. Puccinia is a rust fungus, smuts, etc. They are causing serious diseases to the crop plants. Now, several forms are wood rotters and decomposers of cellulose and lignin. Some toadstools are like mushrooms, they are deadly poisoners, and some others produce hallucinogenic chemicals. I am going to show you some photographs showing the edible fungi. This is Pleurotus, and it is button mushroom, which are edible. And this is Clavatia. And you can see that this is a puffball, because the spores are puffed out. And then this is a rust fungus causing a disease in plants. You can see the rusty nature of the fungus spores. And this is smut fungus seen on corn. These are wood rotting fungi. And this is Amanita muscaria, which is a hallucinogenic fungus. So basidiocarps, the forms can come in different ways, like they can be thin, they can be crust-like, they can be thick and fleshy, gelatinous, spongy, corky, or woody. Like this is thin and crust-like. Now this is gelatinous. These are massive, porky, and wood-dwelling, woody. This is the life cycle of a typical Basidiomycete fungus. It starts its journey from the spore. The spore germinates, and it produces a dikaryotic phase. And on top of the dikaryotic phase, a basidium is produced. And from the basidiospore, from the basidium, four basidiospores are produced exogenously. And these basidiospores are released. They are of plus and minus types, so they produce separate hypha. And then during a particular stage when plasmogamy has to occur, plasmogamy takes place, and then dikaryotization results. And from this dikaryotized mycelium, a primary mycelium, secondary mycelium, dikaryotized mycelium is tertiary secondary mycelium. From the secondary mycelium, a tertiary mycelium containing fruiting body is produced, which later transforms into the spore producing structure, basidiocarps. So that is regarding the general characters of residual carbs. And there are two types that we have to study for this particular group. One is agaricus and the other is succinia. So let's learn about agaricus today. This is a systematic position of this fungus. Kingdom fungi, division Eumycota, subdivision Basidiomycotina, plus Hymenomycetes, order Agaricaceae, and family Agaricaceae. So agaricus, it is also called as Saliota. Saliota is the old name. Now we call it agaricus. So agaricus is a saprophytic fungus, mostly grown in humus-rich soil and also on decaying logs. About 25 species from India are reported. Most are edible, like Agaricus sylvaticus. The spelling is having some mistake. Agaricus sylvaticus, Agaricus xanthodermus, etc. are highly poisonous. So these are poisonous, but edible ones are also there. Like Agaricus campestris is a widely used edible species in Kerala, and it provides an antibiotic called as campestrin. The vegetative body of the agaricus is mycelial. Mycelium is eukaryotic, means it produces two fruit bodies, septate, branched, and subterranean. Subterranean means it grows below the substrate. So it grows saprophytically. Primary, secondary, and tertiary mycelium are seen. The branching hyphae of the secondary mycelium, they form dense underground tangles called as rhizomorphs. Adjacent cells of the mature primary mycelium and secondary mycelium are separated by dolichoceptum, and each septum has a central opening called as dolichore, through which the protoplasmic continuity is maintained. And there are cap-like structures in this dolichore, which are called as paranthosomes. These things that we have already discussed during the general characters of Basidiomycota. In clamp connections, they are absent in agaricus. The tertiary mycelium, it is seen in basidial carps, which are the fruit bodies. The pieces of secondary mycelium are called as spawns, and they are the seeds for mushroom cultivation, which can be grown on medium like the rice grains and all. The basidial carps, they emerge from the rhizomorphs in concentric rings in every growing season with a wider circle. This is called as fairy rings, an extremely beautiful phenomenon. You can see this is a fairy ring because the mycelium, it has spread, and on the outer brim of this mycelium spread, the food bodies have been formed, and every year it grows. So this is again another picture of the fairy ring. Regarding the structure of food bodies, the food bodies are called as basidiocarps or sporophores. They are aerial fructifications. That means they come out of the substratum above ground, and are commonly called as mushrooms. Now, these are the edible parts of agaricus. From the rhizomorph, the basidiocarp arises first through the button stage. A mature basidiocarp is 6 to 9 centimeters long. It has a stout, fleshy and basally swollen stalk or stipe, and a cup-like cap or pileus. In the button stage, the margin of the pileus is joined to the stipe by a membrane called as velum. Now, as the pileus grows further, the velum ruptures and forms a ring around the stipe, and this is called as the annulus. Anatomically, stipe has two parts, namely a cortex and a medulla. Now, cortex is the outer zone, it is formed of pseudoparenchymatous tissue, and medulla is the central zone, which is made up of prosenchymatous tissue. That means more or less compact, which has lost its individuality. So the central zone is more thicker. Now the pileus is initially a fleshy convex structure, but later on it becomes almost flat. On its lower side, there are numerous vertically hanging plate-like structures, which are called as gills or lamellae. Now, the gills are lined by thousands of elongated club-shaped cells called as basidium. Now, each basidium, it bears at its tip four haploid uninucleates and non-motile basidiospores. on each on small stalks, which are called as telegmata. This is the structure of the basidiocarp carp in its young stage. So you can see that the gills are protected by a veil, which is called as partial veil, and the entire food body in its young stage, it is covered by universal veil. And now this is a common feature which is seen not in agaricus, but for general discussion of mushrooms, we use this picture. Because one or many of these structures are absent in many of these mushrooms. In agaricus, you can see only this partial veil. You cannot say the universal veil in agaricus. So this partial veil, it ruptures and forms a ring-like structure around the stipe. And in agaricus, you won't find these cap-like scales or the vulva. This structure is a common structure for mushrooms. I told you that any of these structures can be missing in many mushroom genera. So in agaricus, this annulus is only present. You don't find this vulva. So the cap or the pileus, this is this type. And under the cap or the pileus, you have several gill-like structures which are called as lamellae. Now the structure of gill, structurally a gill has three regions, namely outer hymenium, middle subhymenium and the inner trauma. The hymenium is formed of fertile and sterile cells. The fertile cells are called as basidia and the sterile cells are called as paraphysis. Now the subhymenium, it is formed of small rounded sterile cells. And the central portion, which is called as the trauma, it consists of pseudoparenchymatous tissue. It is formed of long, slender and loosely interwoven hyphae. Now, this is a picture of the gills. If you take a section of the gills, you can see a structure like this. This is the central portion called as trauma. This is the fertile layer called as hymenium, and below the hymenium, there is a layer called as subhymenium. So, in the hymenium, you can also find sterile hyphae, which are called as paraphysis. In the reproduction, agaricus reproduces vegetatively and sexually. Asexual reproduction is not common, but in some species, it may take place by means of chlamydospores or oidium. In the vegetative reproduction, it takes place by means of fragments. For the sexual reproduction, well-differentiated sex organs are absent in the case of agaricus, and the sexual reproduction occurs by somatogamy, followed by events like dikaryotization, karyogamy, meiosis, and basidiospore formation that we have already seen. Now, basidiospores, they are formed exogenously on basidia, which are arranged on gills of basidiocarps. So, the life cycle of agaricus. Agaricus, it produces gills, and under the gills there is a layer called as hymenium. In the hymenium, there are basidia formed, inside which there are basidiospores, and these basidiospores are released and they germinate into a new mycelium. So later they undergo plasmogamy and karyogamy, and then again they form food bodies from the rhizomorphs. Thank you.